Boston Marathon humbly began in 1897 with a field of only 15 runners. But the marathon has changed drastically from its start, now boasting over 30,000 runners. It is the longest continuously running marathon with a record of 123 years. In its first 27 runnings, the race distance was 24.5 miles, but was later changed to the Olympic standard of 26 miles and 385 yards in 1924. But what seems to be the biggest change of all was when women began to run the race. Roberta Bobby Gibb was the first woman to run the race in 1966. But 1 year later, Kathrine Switzer became the first woman to run the race with numbers. So who exactly is Kathrine Switzer? In the winter of 1966, while training with the men's cross-country team at Syracuse, seeing as there were no women's running teams, she began toying with the idea of running the Boston Marathon after her mentor, Arnie Briggs, an over 15-year veteran of the race, told and retold countless stories of Boston. Arnie was shocked at her suggestion to
quit talking about the Boston Marathon and run the damn thing.
No woman can run the Boston Marathon.
Kathrine was outraged at Arnie's statement of women not being able to run, because within the previous year, Bobby Gibb had ran the race without numbers.
Why not? I'm running 10 miles a night.
At the time, it was common belief that women were too fragile to run that far, people saying if they did, they would grow mustaches and chest hair. However, Arnie finally came to a conclusion.
If you ran the distance in practice, I'd be the first to take you to Boston.
3 weeks before the marathon, Arnie came to her dorm and said it was wrong for her to run the race without registering. So they scoured the rule books to see if there were any rules about women not being allowed to run, but they couldn't find any. So she filled out the registration form as K.V. Switzer, due to the fact that her father had spelled her name wrong on her birth certificate, got cleared by the doctor, and put down the $3 entry fee. Registering with her was her boyfriend, Tom Miller, an ex-American football player, and John Leonard, a member of the Syracuse cross-country team. When they got to Boston, Arnie insisted on driving the course. Kathrine said,
"It is totally demoralizing to see how far 26 miles actually is."
Kathrine then called her parents, who all had been left in the dark about the marathon, telling them,
"It is important for me to finish the race."
Her dad responded,
"Aw, hell, kid, you can do it."
The day of the marathon, Kathrine donned her burgundy race outfit plus her treasured gray sweatshirt, which she pinned her numbers onto. The final commitment of going all 26 miles and 385 yards. In the warm-up area, Kathrine was greeted by many other runners, all ecstatic that there was a girl running. One even asked for tips on how to get his wife to start running too. Then the gun went off. At mile two, the press trucks came barreling down the road, and Kathrine started to grab all the attention from the press trucks. Photographers were excited to see a girl in the race. However, Jock Semple, a race official notorious for his vision of keeping the race pure, that is, any non-serious runners would be kicked out, usually forcibly removed by Jock himself. Kathrine heard the scraping noise of leather shoes coming up fast behind her. Kathrine looked back and was met by a man's face, contorted with anger, screaming, "Get the hell out of my race and give me those numbers!" Jock swiped at her chest number, but Kathrine turned away. However, Jock had his hand on her sweatshirt and was grasping for her bib number on the back. Then, her boyfriend, Tom Miller, rushed at Jock with a crossbody block, sending him flying across the pavement. Kathrine was shocked. Arnie said,
"Run like hell."
So they ran. But the press truck followed, catching up to them, with all the reporters on board shouting questions like, "What are you trying to prove? When are you going to quit?" Kathrine was infuriated, making it clear that she wasn't trying to prove anything. She just wanted to run. Kathrine then turned to Arnie, a newfound courage in her voice.
"Arnie, I have to finish this race. I have to, even on my hands and knees. If I don't finish, people will say women can't do it. So I'm finishing."
Kathrine crossed the finish line in 4 hours, 20 minutes, although that is an official time. The AAU didn't give her a ranking in the final results. At the finish, Kathrine's shoes and socks were soaked with blood, a result of several pop blisters, but she couldn't be happier. On the long drive back to Syracuse, the crew stopped at a gas station for gas and coffee. That's when Kathrine saw the newspapers. They were covered front and back in their photos. The papers hailed her as pretty, fair, fantasy girl, spunky, a damsel in distress. Race official Will Cloney was quoted in newspapers saying, "I'm terribly disappointed that American girls force their way into something where they're neither eligible nor wanted." It wasn't until this moment that Kathrine really understood how much she had broken the barrier in women's marathoning. But she ran with it. Kathrine soon became an advocate for women's running. She continued to run the Boston Marathon, however unregistered. 1972 was a big year for women's athletics, with the passing of Title IX, Boston allowing women to officially run, and Kathrine's endorsement of the first women's only 10K in New York City. Then, starting in 1974, the AAU held the first women's marathon championship. After Boston allowed women to run, Kathrine wasn't done advocating for women's running at all. Her next goal? Get the marathon in the Olympics. Easier said than done. The requirements for an event to go Olympic were harsh, stating that there had to be participation from at least 25 countries on three continents. Plus, the International Olympic Committee still held tight to the perception that women were unable to run such distances. She soon got in touch with Avon Cosmetics. In 1976, she met with executives at a women's athletic event and partnered with them to help create the Avon International Women's Marathon in 1978. The first of these marathons took place in Atlanta, Georgia, boasting 136 runners from 9 countries. Avon soon launched running events in 27 countries on 5 continents. This and other women's races gained the attention of the IAAF, and in 1980, the IAAF held concurrent races for women at all men's events. The Avon races had surpassed the International Olympic Committee's requirements, but the event had to gain approval from the Los Angeles Olympic Organizing Committee. In March of 1980, the LAOOC was reluctant to obtain the burden of adding any more events. Even though women's running events were endorsed by many other committees and organizations, the LAOOC still stood firm in not adding any women's events. Meanwhile, the IAAF had recognized the 5,000 meters and 10,000 meters as world record distances for women, and the 1983 World Championships in Helsinki would contain a women's marathon. Finally, in late February of 1981, a vote was held. With a 7-1 verdict, the singular opposing country being the USSR, the women's marathon was officially passed as an Olympic event. Now retired from competitive marathoning, Kathrine was asked to commentate the inaugural women's marathon in Los Angeles. The race consisted of a huge field of 50 runners. The conditions were grueling, with temperatures reaching over 80 degrees.
Again, very psyched, and Joni, who's overcome many difficulties and is probably one of America's very best athletes of all time, is really deserving of this.
That was Kathrine commentating. Joan Benoit, winner of the 1983 Boston Marathon, came out victorious.
She has done it. Joan Benoit.
Kathrine had broken the barrier into competitive women's marathoning. 50 years later, she once again returned to Boston, running officially in 4 hours 41 minutes. She has also become an Emmy Award-winning TV commentator, covering several Olympic Games, national championships, and every televised Boston Marathon for the past 40 years. Her biggest project is her nonprofit, 261 Fearless, using running to empower women all over the world. And it has. Keep on running.